Sorry, I'm just making sure these power plants. Hope everyone is enjoying lunch. My name is Tim Argetsinger, political advisor with ITK. I'm part of the team, the larger team of people who drafted the actual text of the strategy. And thanks. So the purpose of the presentation today is just to take you through a quick summary overview of the contents of the strategy, to provide a bit of the background and rationale behind the strategy. Many of the points of which people, past speakers that we've heard this morning, have alluded to. So just to begin, I know we have a couple screens, the one here and the one here. I'm going to be using a PowerPoint. So just a visual of the geographic, cultural, and political region that we refer to when we use the term Inuit Nunangat. So Inuit Nunangat falls within the territories and provinces of the Northwest Territories, Nunavut, Quebec, Newfoundland, and Labrador. And you can see the carve out on the screen there. So in total, Inuit Nunangut comprises about 36% of Canada's landmass and 50% of its total coastline. So it is a large area. The Inuit governance structure that Natan and others have referred to, it extends, as you can see, from every individual Inuk who's a beneficiary of one of the four Inuit land claims organizations, up to their respective Inuit representational organization at the regional level, which then feeds into the ITK board and the work we do at the national level. So this is just a visual representation of that Inuit democratic governance structure. Another visual of who the leaders are within Inuit Nunangut that govern the space. So Duane Smith is the president of the Nunavut Regional Corporation, whose lands are in the northern part of the Northwest Territories. Luki Kotier, who's the Nunavut Tungavik Incorporated president. Charlie Watt Sr., who's the president of Makavik Corporation. And Johannes Lamp, who is the president of the Nunatsiavut government. And of course, the ITK board of directors, who are those leaders, then direct the work we do at Inuit Tabari Kanatimi, based here in Ottawa. In addition to those four voting members of the board, we have Nancy Karatuk-Lindell, who is the vice president of ITK and the president of Inuit Circumpolar Council Canada, Rebecca Kudlu, who is the president of Pauktutuit Inuit Women of Canada, and Kavio, who is the president of the National Inuit Youth Council. And Natan Olbed, of course, who's the president of ITK. The National Inuit Strategy on Research is something that was about 18 months in the making. The work on the strategy was advised by the IQNC, the Inuit Kalisatlunyad National Committee, who is itself made up of representatives from each of the Inuit Nunangut regions that I just mentioned. What the National Inuit Strategy on Research actually does is three main things. It promotes a shared understanding of the legacy of Inuit Nunangut research and connects this legacy to the current research context. This is something that Natan provided an overview of earlier. It defines Inuit expectations for the role of research in our regions and communities. And it identifies areas for partnership and action between Inuit and the research community. So those areas for partnership and action are outlined in part two of the actual document. So that's where you find the objectives and actions. There are, I believe, 19 objectives and 27 actions. These are areas for partnership between Inuit and governments and academic institutions. So those objectives and actions are organized by priority areas. There are five priority areas in the strategy, as you can see here. And past speakers have mentioned some of them, but advancing Inuit governance in research, enhancing the ethical conduct of research, aligning funding, with Inuit internet research priorities and ensuring Inuit access, control over data information, and building capacity within Inuit, the Inuit internet research community. Now, I'm going to get into a bit of the rationale behind each of these priority areas a bit later. Within the strategy, the infographics that we created that are included really tell the story of the larger problem and also describe solutions to address those problems. Natan described earlier the view of Inuit internet as sort of a blank space. In many ways, that can be seen in the way that Inuit Nunavut or the Arctic is described, is really a kind of a crazy quilt of different descriptions. So you have, for example, the Inuit Nunavut regions, but then you have terms like north of 60, which are really an imperfect fit for the region that we're talking about. So when you look at the definition of north of 60, you see that it cuts off Nunatsiavut region and also Nunavik in northern Quebec, some of the communities within Nunavik. We've seen other categories for the application of research in this broad region that we call the Arctic, like the Department of Fisheries and Oceans has a different way of describing the space. So you see the central and Arctic region, so some of it overlaps with Inuit Nunavut. Other regions don't. And as a third example, we have the Public Works and Government Services Canada regions in which their work is administered. So you've got Western, which includes Nunavut and the Inuvialuit Settlement region, and then Quebec. So the Inuit Nunavut research, when we talk about, when we use that term, it is really the Inuit preferred term for describing this the area in which research is carried out. Another helpful infographic that I think tells part of the story and identifies part of the problem well is this one. So this infographic shows how as over time the research burden or the amount of publications on Inuit and Inuit Nunavut related research have increased over time. And you see in 2011 there, I think the small caption, which I can't read, is that for every three Inuit, there is a one research publication. I can't see the text, but. Now this is a critical piece, the social and economic inequities dimension of Inuit Nunavut research. It is really the question of who benefits from Inuit Nunavut research. This is just a snapshot of social and economic inequities that exist, and I think it's helpful for highlighting the potential role of research in addressing these priorities or these issues when they line up with Inuit priorities. So for example, when we were working on the National Suicide Prevention Strategy, which was released in the summer of 2016, one of the areas or the data that we were looking for are just the rates of suicide among Inuit by region. And so in the Northwest Territories, that information, just the rate, which is a information that consider kind of basic, was not disaggregated. So we had to go in and actually look through the coroner's data to identify that Inuit specific rate within that region. So similarly for things, information like suicide attempts, that is among Inuit, that is information that that we don't have across Inuit Nunavut. Second infographic, or this infographic, it reflects kind of the manner in which Inuit Nunavut research is carried out by different actors within Canada. So there are a variety of departments that are involved in Inuit Nunavut research. There isn't necessarily a hub or a single entity that coordinates all Inuit Nunavut research. So this is part of the challenge that we encounter when we are looking to address some of the gaps in research governance or access and ownership over data. It's just navigating this terrain of different actors. This infographic here, implementing a coordinated approach to Inuit Nunangut research. It is a visual representation of just the really reflects the vision of how different actors who carry out Inuit Nunangut research could partner with our governance structure to ensure that research is more effective, impactful, and useful to the majority population that lives in the area. So getting to the priorities and objectives and actions, these are some, just warning you, some text-heavy slides, so I'll just focus on maybe the overarching rationale behind each of the priority areas. So under the first priority area, advancing Inuit governance and research, you can see the objectives here. I'd say the overarching problem that these objectives and corresponding actions seek to address is the inconsistency with which research institutions or governance engage with the Inuit governance structure to determine at a really basic level, for example, what the priorities are, research priorities are that regions may have, how they wish to engage in different federal research initiatives, who should lead or coordinate the conduct of research on those priority areas. So these objectives and actions lay out a vision for how to improve those relationships. This second priority, enhancing the ethical conduct of research, really has to do with ensuring that the research community is carrying out research in a way that is consistent with and respectful of the right of Inuit to self-determination in research, including just the manner in which research relationships are brokered with communities, with regions, with Inuit representational organizations, and identifies solutions for how to improve what currently exists. Aligning funding with Inuit research priorities, I mentioned this earlier, speaks to the need to ensure that going back to, for example, those inequities that I just identified, that the research is investments are really complementing the needs that exist and building on the governance piece. Ensuring Inuit access, ownership, and control over data and information. This is an important component. I mean, in the work that we do at ITK and with regions, say through the Inuit Crown Partnership Committee, for example, and the priorities that we've identified to work on in research, some of the good research that has come out of, say, the Inuit Health Survey, for example, really informs almost every one of those priority areas, whether it is in the areas of housing or language or health and wellness. And that information is helpful in part because the research was done in close partnership with Inuit, and the dissemination of the information back to Inuit regions has been done in a way that has been largely useful. And last priority area, building capacity for Inuit Nunangut research. I mean, this priority area speaks to the potential for initiatives like the development of an Inuit Nunangut University, which Paul Davidson has been instrumental in championing, and it is imagining things like the role that institutional review boards, or I guess in Canada, REBs could play if they were actually within Inuit Nunangut, an instrumental role that having research review committees within Inuit Nunangut could play in determining, for example, what the priorities are in the regions and reviewing research project proposals that, that come through regions. The implementation phase is what comes after this release. Gregor mentioned earlier the need for the implementation plan, which we'll be developing in the next few months. But because of just the different actors that have a role in Inuit Internet research, and the variants and the actions that we've identified, those are really just a starting place, and they are going to require that we broker those relationships with federal departments, with potentially provincial and territorial departments, with academic institutions to determine how we move forward. This is it is a starting point, but in those world. And discussions that we continue to have. I know we briefed several departments, many of which have representatives in the room already, so we look forward to continuing the work. And if you have any questions, we welcome them at this time. And I may call on my colleague, Scott Nichols, to join me if there are any questions. Yeah,
if you have any questions, you can come to this microphone.
Great.
We're very clear.
Hi, my name is Peter Pulsper. I'm at the University of Colorado. I also do some work with IDK as well. I've just returned from a meeting in Lapland, Finland, and some of these topics were discussed there, particularly by people with Sami Council and some other groups. And I'm just wondering what your thoughts are in terms of making, well, both your thoughts about how this could link to the international sphere, you know, for Inuit around the polar Arctic, as well as what you may be learning or connecting with groups like Sami Council and others on these really important topics.
I think there are helpful lessons to be learned from other jurisdictions. In Alaska, where I'm from, for example, the Alaska Native Health Consortium is sort of the overarching governance regime when it comes to health research that involves Alaska Native peoples and communities. So the institutional review board that they have in place at the state level has a second tier at the regional level. So the Alaska Native Health providers in the regions then have their own review process, and then at the community level, tribal governments have their own research review process as well. So at each of those tiers, there is an opportunity essentially for communities or for tribes, tribal governments, or the regional health associations, Alaska Native Health Associations, or at the state level, to review research proposals and potentially suggest ways to improve on those proposals or to articulate expectations or possibly to even veto project proposals. So there are regions where there are much more stringent research regimes in place that help ensure that some of the issues that I just talked about are addressed. So I think there's great potential as we're looking for how to proceed, what the best people to connect with would be.
Thanks. Great. Thank you. And I just say, I think the rest of the world will see this as a great model to work from.
Thanks.
Hi, Tim. I'm Darren Gilmore from the Royal Society of Canada. For organizations, universities, agencies that wish to support this work, beyond communicating the good news as energetically and as widely and as quickly, as comprehensively as we can, are there other specific things that a community of allies ought to be doing to mobilize the energies of the first year of sharing the strategy as you develop the implementation plan?
That's a good question. I haven't thought about what outside actors could be doing. I think the messaging that we've tried to be consistent in using, whether it is in the area of research or in suicide prevention, that has started to percolate up. So it's the sharing the message and understanding about just what the expectation is for partnership on things like research, the understanding of how the Inuit democratic governance structure works and how it should be engaged on research matters or on any other issue. I mean, that kind of basic understanding of how the Inuit democratic structure works probably is something that you could link to in the work that you do.
Thanks. Congratulations.
Thanks. All right. Anyone else? Last call. Questions? All right. Thank you, everyone. Appreciate it.
Tim, so this concludes all the speakers and presentations for today. So enjoy your dessert and enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you so much for coming today.